was not on the agenda of the colonizers, and discrimination was more a practice of power than even a word. This is the United Nations on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples Act engagement session on the Maang, Loon, Dodem. Okay, and this is the impacts of the UNDRIP, which would be surrounding the duties and responsibilities of the Maang, Dodem. So the UNDRIP says, we have organized the UNDRIP information sessions to be based on the Anishinaabe. Oh, I got to get rid of this thing here. Sorry, I had to get rid of my all the participants because it was crossed over. We have organized the UNDRIP information sessions to be based on the Anishinaabe Dodem system. According to Gordon Wainman's Ba, the Anishinaabe Dodem or clan system is a complete form of governance. When the seven primary Dodems take care of their responsibilities, there would be no other issues for Anishinaabe to be concerned about. The Anishinaabe Dodem system is comprehensive. Edward Benton, in his book Mishomas, the late Edward Benton, The Voice of the Ojibwe, said the people of the Maang Loon clan alongside the Crane clan were given the power of chieftainship because they had natural abilities to do leadership. So they worked together. Each claiming to be the original chief or clan Dodem, they were both given the respective chieftainship, worked together to bring balance to the government, with each serving as a check on the other. Between the two chief clans, Dodems, stood the fish, which was sometimes referred to as the water clan Dodem. The fish Dodem, fish Dodem members would settle disputes between the two chief Dodems, between the Loon and between the Crane. If there was a deciding vote that needed to be cast, this built-in ability of the Dodem system to resolve differences of opinion greatly added to its effectiveness as a governing body. This has been interpreted to include such things as equality and discrimination, human rights and racism, wills and estates, and employment and labor. All of those things are responsible factors of the Maang. Applying the Loon Dodem perspective to the updating of federal legislation and the implementation of UNDRIP, it has been determined there are many current categories of federal legislative responsibility that would be included. The following are some of those Dodem responsibilities, issues, and relevant UNDRIP articles. The entire colonial process was based on the subjugation and genocide of the Indigenous peoples. Equality was not on the agenda of the colonizers, and discrimination was more a practice of power than even a word, which was not defined until the 17th century. So there was not even a definition for the word discrimination until the 17th century. By this time, Indigenous peoples were already seriously reduced in numbers, greatly impacted, discriminated upon, and suffered for reasons of their race, culture, language, spiritual, and traditional beliefs. Indigenous peoples were denied the basic human rights that today make up the international human rights, which are the basic rights and freedoms that human beings are entitled. Canada also has a civil and human rights code, which is entrenched in the Constitution of Canada of 1982. This is the supreme law for Canada. In 1982, the Canadian Constitution, Section 35, reaffirmed and recognized treaty rights and the rights of Aboriginal people. They say Aboriginal people. The Canadian Constitution was a game changer for Indigenous people. Utilizing the human rights for equality against discrimination and racism created case law, which continues to evolve and advance our nations today. We have come a long way, but we still have a journey to continue. Anishinaabe people have experienced significant losses due to discrimination, racism, and inequality in basically every aspect of their lives, from and not limited to residential schools, child welfare systems, the 60 scoop, millennium scoop, youth overrepresentation in detention institutions, adults over incarceration rates, no rights to vote, methods of segregation, such as the reservation system, inequalities in education, healthcare, child welfare, disparities of care, salary inequalities, token positions of employment, housing inequalities, poor health care, on and on. So we're going to try to stick basically to the information that's specific to the Loon clan. Because when you look at the responsibilities and duties of the Loon clan, you're going to see that it actually can involve the entire UNDRIP. So we don't have time to go over the entire UNDRIP. But basically, the UNDRIP would be completely involved of the Loon clan. So for wills and estates, Anishinaabe people that hold possession of property lands on First Nations must have their wills approved by the Minister of Indian Affairs to ensure the heirs to the reserve land is to another member of that particular First Nation. With some First Nations examining their intentions for their own citizenship code for their nations, this will be significant for those that have few options for heirs to their estate. Many families have members that are not status. Creating successors to First Nation lands can be challenging. There is a lower threshold for First Nations when it comes to making a will by only ensuring the qualifying features are identified to express their wishes for their estate. The process is less formal. Wills and estates for First Nations people who are ordinarily resident on a reserve or on Crown land are not governed by the Wills Act or the Succession Law Reform Act. Estates living off reserve. If a First Nation person was living off a reserve at the time of death, the estate is the responsibility of the province, territory, or country where they live. All off-reserve specifications would be in place in accordance with the SLRA. So all they really need to do with a First Nations will is just to make sure that whoever is the benefactor of receipt of the property is somebody that is legally entitled to. Estates living on a reserve with a will, First Nations can leave a certificate of possession for land to a family member as long as they are able to inherit the CP land. They must be members of the same band. If a First Nation person usually lives or lived on a reserve, their estate is handled by Crown Indigenous Relations in Northern Ontario or Northern Affairs Canada, sorry. Under the Indian Act, CERNAC can appoint estate administrators or executors. Approve wills so they can take effect, transfer reserve lands from the estate to heirs or beneficiaries, determine the heirs if someone dies without a will, serve as administrator if the family does not or cannot settle the estate. If CERNAC is the administrator, it will distribute estate assets according to the will or the intestacy provisions of the Indian Act. Invalidating a will. Under Section 46(1) of the Indian Act, the Minister of CERNAC has the authority to invalidate a will under certain circumstances. The minister can invalidate a will if it was executed under duress or undue influence. That means the person or the testator, the one making the will, was put under pressure to sign the will and they did not want to do so. The person whose will it is did not have the capacity. That means the person that was making the will did not have the mental ability to do so. That could be somebody that was under the influence of something or dementia, you know, for those kinds of reasons. The will would impose hardship on those whom the testator should have provided for, such as dependent children. The will disposed of reserve land against the interests of the band. The terms of the will are vague or uncertain, or the terms are against public interest. Transferring an interest in reserve lands. Reserve lands are owned by the Crown for the use and benefit of band members. Band members must obtain a CP from the band, which shows what share of the reserve land belongs to that individual member, similar to title deed elsewhere. An interest in reserve lands can only be transferred in accordance with the Indian Act. Specifically, pursuant to Section 50 of the Indian Act, an interest in reserve lands can only be transferred to other members of the band that have a right to reside on the reserve lands. Consequently, a band member cannot gift his or her interest in reserve land to someone who is not a band member of the same band. Valid will under the Indian Act. The formal requirements for the will of an Indigenous person who lived on reserve does not have to conform to provincial succession law reform acts. Rather, under Section 45(2) of the Indian Act, a will is valid as long as it is in writing, signed by the person whose will it is, that would be the testator, and indicates the wishes of the testator with respect to how their property should be dispersed or disposed of. Employment and labor. Indigenous people are one of the four groups of designated by the Employment Equity Act, along with visible minorities, people with disabilities, and women. Effective April 2012, all departments and agencies under the Public Service Employment Act are required to use an affirmation of Aboriginal affiliation form for advertised and non-advertised internal and external appointment processes when the persons proposed for appointment or appointed have self-declared as Aboriginal and the appointment process, one, has a selection limited to Aboriginal peoples or members of designated employment equity groups that included Aboriginal peoples, or has applied as a merit criterion the organizational need of increasing the representation of Aboriginal peoples or increasing the representation of members of designated groups, including Aboriginal peoples, or involves selection from an Aboriginal inventory or student employment programs in the federal government used to increase the representation of Aboriginal peoples or of designated groups, including Aboriginal peoples. The courts have determined that for the purposes of Section 87 of the Indian Act, employment income is personal property. In the case of employment income earned by an Indian, therefore, what must be determined is whether the employment income is situated on a reserve. The courts have directed that connecting factors must be considered when making this determination. Revenue Canada, after receiving representations from interested Indian groups and individuals, has identified several connecting factors that can be used to determine whether their employment income is situated on a reserve. The location of employment duties is a major connecting factor. However, the department also recognizes that employees of bands, tribal councils, or organizations that operate on behalf of band or tribal councils may perform most of their activities off reserve. For employees, the connection to a reserve is that the employer is resident on a reserve and the Indian is employed in a non-commercial activity for the social, cultural, educational, or economic development of Indians who, for the most part, live on reserves. With a view to assisting the Indian community, the department has developed the following guidelines, incorporating the various relevant connecting factors that describe the employment situations covered by Section 87 of the Indian Act. The treatment of other income related to employment is also discussed. Employment and labor. It should be noted that when applying all the connecting factors, there may be unusual or exceptional circumstances where, one, the income may not be taxable, even though it does not fall within one of the guidelines, or the income may be taxable, even though it appears to fall within one of the guidelines. So these are not, there's no black and white, circumstances will still prevail. It's all circumstantial, depends on what your situation is. Sometimes they'll just say, if they can't really decide, sometimes they'll say, just submit your information at tax time and we'll get your money back. Guideline one, when at least 90% of the duties of an employment are performed on a reserve, all of the income of an Indian from that employment will usually be exempt from income tax. Guideline two, when the employer is resident on a reserve and the Indian lives on a reserve, all of the income of an Indian from employment will usually be exempt from income tax. So those are kind of hard and fast, guideline one and guideline two.
So can we interject with questions here?
Yeah.
Okay, it's just on the employment income. Does the nuances of the current remote work environment fall under the determination of circumstances to say that with remote work where you may have been in office previously off reserve for an off reserve employer, now that you're working remotely, you're living on reserve and working 100% of your time or up to 100% on reserve, So those deciding factors would still prevail, or would there be a new category of remote work situations?
No, I think it would fit into that. It would fit into that. If you've been, it would qualify you. Like if you're doing work for your First Nation, or even if you're not working for a First Nation and you're living on your reserve and you're supposed to be paying taxes, your duties are being performed on the First Nation.
Okay, so that's my situation. I initially, my employer is off reserve. I was initially taxed. Last year, I made a submission for tax exemption. I work remotely on reserve, live on reserve. I have never left my reserve since the pandemic hit. So that there has been no issue. I'm able to get, only because I processed the documentation, but my fear is, given the fact that, you know, there's times when you're audited and a misunderstanding of the application of this guideline, could I be subject to scrutiny and be determined to be ineligible for the tax exemption, or people similar to my situation?
You should be able to get it. You should be able, there should be a connecting factor there that you can be eligible for. You're going to have some cooperation from your employer to say that you are doing your services from home, you're remotely performing your duties. And then you just have to give them some proof that you're living in the First Nation by providing them what the First Nation address, those kinds of things. But that would be something you would have to provide to, like, you have to pay your income tax first. Yeah. And then when you do your taxes at the end of the year, you submit that information, and then you should get all your money back. All your taxes should be given back.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. And I have another question on the issue that you had back there around wills and estates. Mm-hmm. With, I guess, remote work or... So the determination of the definition, normally living on reserve. Mm-hmm. When you are a resident, or say you have a home off reserve, but your employment is on reserve, requiring you to live on reserve, i.e. for an island community and you're working on the ferry, you have to be on the island side to respond to your shift. Mm-hmm. would that be a scenario that could be a stretch of the definition of living on reserve for the purpose of employment?
Well, where is your address physically located?
Well, it's both, really. You have a reserve address and you have a mainland municipal address.
Okay.
Because you occupy two homes.
Yeah. So you would say that you're ordinarily a resident in your First Nation community, right?
Yeah. Okay. And I have one more question in terms of wills and estates. So with the citizenship issue, I think, you know, it's becoming more and more aware to a lot of people that if our grandchildren are not likely to be eligible to be status Indian. So for those of us grandparents who hold land, i.e. CP, and when we're preparing our will, how can we legally or create some kind of legal mechanism so that our CP family lands still remain in our family, even though our heirs may not be a member of the community according to Indian Act's rules? Is there any kind of legal, like a leasing arrangement for $1 a year or something that can be put in place?
Well, I've done wills with First Nation members from different communities, and how we've been able to get around it is through the matrimonial laws. Right,
property, yeah. Right?
Where some people that are definitely not band members, you know, they've been married on, they're not status. They've been able to obtain a life interest to occupy the property. And after the life interest is up, there would be a successor to that is status.
Okay, so the status issue still comes into play at some point.
That's right. So there still is. However, you'd have to find some resolution to it. Like, your idea is good, where you say, you know what, the property is going to be there, and they could be a leaser of the land from the First Nation. the First Nation would definitely have to be in agreement with that kind of thing.
So they'd have to be a party to that CP?
Yeah.
Through your will?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
But if you had somebody that could hold it even in trust for that time, but you know, it's kind of hard to determine that for years to follow.
Like exactly.
You can't manage that property from the grave.
So yeah.
You can only do that for so long, right?
But while I'm here, I want to create a legal pathway to ensure my grandchildren and their children get benefit to our family land without this whole Indian status issue.
That's right. So what the hope is that by the time your grandchildren are old enough, that they'll have some kind of citizenship law that's in the community that would say we're going to have one parent rule. So they would be able to manage that themselves rather than the status being the
status designation. Yeah. Okay. Thank you for that.
So it's important that we do our citizenship laws for those very reasons. Okay. So we're going to go on to guideline number 3. When there is more than 50% of the duties of employment are performed on a reserve and the employer is resident on a reserve or the Indian lives on a reserve, all of the income of an Indian from an employment will usually be exempt from income tax. So at least 50% of the duties. So that would probably cover in that situation, somebody that ordinarily lives on the reserve and they still do duties off the reserve for whatever reason, right? So if you can say that you're at least 50% of the time, then you should be able to get your income tax. Guideline 4, the employer is resident on reserve and the employer is an Indian band which has a reserve or a tribal council representing one or more of the Indian bands which have reserves or an Indian organization controlled by one or more such bands or tribal councils if the organization is dedicated exclusively to the social, cultural, educational, or economic development of Indians who for the most part live on reserves and the duties of the employment are in connection with the employer's non-commercial activities carried on exclusively for the benefit of Indians who for the most part live on reserves, all of the income of an Indian from an employment will usually be exempt from income tax. So those up to guideline 4 are exempt. Okay, employment related income. The receipt of unemployment insurance benefits, retiring allowances, Canada pension plan payments, Quebec pension plan payments, registered pension plan benefits or wage loss replacement plan benefits, that's a mouthful, will usually be exempt from income tax when received as a result of employment income that was exempt from tax. If a portion of the employment income was exempt, then a similar portion of these amounts will be exempt. So they're saying all of those things that were listed, Canada pension plan, registered retirement pension plans, wage loss, like employment insurance, those kind of things, those should be exempt as well. So if you've had an employer where you were exempt from paying taxes and then you go on employment insurance and then all of a sudden they take off taxes, well, they shouldn't do that. You should get all the tax back because you did all the work. You performed all the duties on the First Nation. Like you followed all of the guidelines and you never paid tax before. So you shouldn't be paying the tax if you get these benefits either. Like if you have RSPs, say you have a pension plan through your organization, First Nations organization or Indigenous organization, then you should be able to get your pension plan when you cash it in, RSPs, those kinds of things. You shouldn't be paying tax on those things either.
So Kathy, that would be an issue that you'd have to take up with CRA and not so much the financial institution or entity that's holding those, i.e. the pension plans or RSP.
Yeah, but all you need to do is provide that you did have, your employment was from that particular organization. You do need to have
CRA, right?
Yeah, you send that in and you'll get all the money back.
Okay, because when you have those released from a financial institution, i.e. TD Bank or whatever, they tax that source. So it's up to you.
Yeah, but you got to remember, if you have this just from your bank account, it's a private thing. It's not, it doesn't have anything to do with your job. If you get it off of your job, if this is a benefit of your work, then it should be noted on the file. But if you go into your bank
and buy an RSP,
it doesn't have the same tax benefits. So you got to remember that.
Unless your bank is situated on reserve.
Yes. Yes, okay. That's correct.
Yes, that's I'm going to move my accounts over to RAMA.
That's right. That's right.
All right. Thank you.
First Nation employers are not automatically covered by federal employment and labor laws by virtue of Section 9124 of the Constitution. The presumption is that all employers, even First Nations, are under provincial employment laws. There can be dual jurisdiction depending on the test. Okay, moving forward with Dodem governance. The Truth and Reconciliation Commission released in 2015 the 94 calls to action. Within this extensive report can be found the results noted from engagements across the country with those individuals that wish to share their personal truths and experiences and provide direction or recommendations on a healing path forward. Every one of the 94 calls to action are all directly related to equality, discrimination, human rights, and racism that has been imposed upon Indigenous people since the beginning of colonization. The foundation of colonization is genocidal discrimination, racism, and infractions of human rights of Indigenous peoples. The Maang Dodem has a significant role to play in pushing forward the calls to action, as this is precisely aligned with the purpose and the role of the Maang Dodem. The 94 calls to action are a significant key to fulfilling the role and intention of the Maang Dodem. Subtopics of the Maang Dodem align with the TRC at every level, inclusive of matters of wills and estates and the employment and labor for Indigenous peoples. Implementing all 94 calls to action of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission would be one of the objectives of the Maang Dodem. So that would be a pursuit of the Maang Dodem. That would be one of their responsibilities. And ensuring that, because it was when it was within the TRC that they said the UNDRIP was important to implement. When reviewing the UNDRIP articles, please keep these tips in mind. The UN Declaration sets out the minimum rights of Aboriginal people. The preamble provides a background to the United Nations Declaration, including its purpose and how to interpret the rights. The articles set out the rights. They are the heart of the UN Declaration. Articles should be read together. We must not think of each article as a separate from other articles. The UN Declaration recognizes rights of individual Aboriginal people, but also recognizes that some rights are collective rights belonging to entire communities or nations of peoples. The UN Declaration should be read with other international human rights instruments to understand the full range of Aboriginal people's rights. Relevant UNDRIP articles. Human rights issues of discrimination and racism are the foundations and focus of the entire document of UNDRIP articles. It would not be practical for us to include all 46 articles of UNDRIP. For purposes of this document and this presentation, and the intention of the Anishinaabeg Nation having various presentations on other respective dotems that also include and overlap in various articles, we will keep our presentation today within the limits of what the internal Maang Gima would attend to. In consideration of the role of the Maang Dodem and the internal relations for this specific document, we will focus largely upon internal matters of the nation and the subtopics identified. Oops. Article 1, Indigenous peoples have the right to the full enjoyment as a collective or as individuals of all 8 human rights and fundamental freedoms as recognized in the Charter of United Nations, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and International Human Rights Law. We have to also remember when they're talking about Indigenous peoples, this is on a global scale. So sometimes you might read it and go, well, that really doesn't make sense for us. But we got to think about it on a global perspective because these UNDRIP articles were intended to be applied globally. And we're going to look at it from our own perspective right now. Article 2, Indigenous peoples and individuals are free and equal to all other peoples and individuals and have the right to be free from any kind of discrimination in the exercise of their rights, in particular that based on their Indigenous origin or identity. Article 4, Indigenous peoples in exercising their right to self-determination have the right to autonomy or self-government in matters relating to their internal and local affairs, as well as ways and means for financing their autonomous functions. Article 7, Indigenous individuals have the rights to life, physical, mental, integrity, liberty, security of the person. Indigenous peoples have the collective right to live in freedom, peace, and security as distinct peoples and shall not be subjected to any act of genocide or any other act of violence, including forcibly removing children of the group to another group. Article 9, Indigenous peoples and individuals have the right to belong to an Indigenous community or nation in accordance with the traditions and customs of the community or nation concerned. No discrimination of any kind may arise from the exercise of such a right. Article 15, Indigenous peoples have the right to the dignity and diversity of their cultures, traditions, histories, and aspirations, which shall be appropriately reflected in education and public information. States shall take effective measures in consultation and cooperation with the Indigenous peoples concerned to combat prejudice and eliminate discrimination and to promote tolerance, understanding, and good relations among Indigenous peoples in all other segments of society. Article 16, Indigenous peoples have the right to establish their own media in their own languages and to have access to all forms of non-Indigenous media without discrimination. States shall take effective measures to ensure the state-owned media duly reflect Indigenous cultural diversity. States, without prejudice to ensuring full freedom of expression, should encourage privately owned media to adequately reflect Indigenous cultural diversity. Article 17, Indigenous individuals and peoples have the right to enjoy fully all rights established under applicable international and domestic labor law. States shall, in consultation and cooperation with Indigenous peoples, take specific measures to protect Indigenous children from economic exploitation and from performing any work that is likely to be hazardous or to interfere with the child's education or to be harmful to the child's health or physical, mental, spiritual, moral, or social development, taking into account their special vulnerability and the importance of education for their empowerment. Indigenous individuals have the right not to be subjected to any discriminatory conditions of labor and inter alia employment or salary. Article 21. Indigenous peoples have the right without discrimination to the improvement of their economic and social conditions, including inter alia in the areas of education, employment, vocational training, retraining, housing, sanitation, health, and social security. States shall take effective measures and, where appropriate, special measures to ensure continuing improvement of their economic and social conditions. Particular attention shall be paid to the rights and special needs of Indigenous elders, women, youth, children, and persons with disabilities. Article 22, particular attention shall be paid to the rights and special needs of Indigenous elders, women, youth, children, and persons with disabilities in the implementation of this declaration. States shall take measures in conjunction with Indigenous peoples to ensure that Indigenous women and children enjoy the full protection and guarantees against all forms of violence and discrimination. Article 34, Indigenous peoples have the right to promote, develop, and maintain their institutional structures and their distinctive customs, spirituality, traditions, procedures, practices, and in the cases where they exist, judicial systems or customs, in accordance with international human rights standards. Article 35, Indigenous peoples have the right to determine the responsibilities of individuals to their communities. Article 44, all the rights and freedoms recognized herein are equally guaranteed to male and female Indigenous individuals. Article 45, nothing in this declaration may be construed as diminishing or extinguishing the rights Indigenous peoples have now or may acquire in the future. Article 46, nothing in this declaration may be interpreted as implying for any state, people, group, or person any right to engage in any activity or to perform any act contrary to the Charter of the United Nations or construed as authorizing or encouraging any action which would dismember or impair totally or in part the territorial integrity or political unity of sovereign and independent states. In the exercise of the rights enunciated in the present declaration, human rights and fundamental freedoms of all shall be respected. The exercise of the rights set forth in this declaration shall be subject only to such limitations as are determined by law and in accordance with the international human rights obligations. Any such limitations shall be non-discriminatory and strictly necessary solely for the purpose of securing due recognition and respect for the rights and freedoms of others and for meeting the just and most compelling requirements of a democratic society. The provisions set forth in this declaration shall be interpreted in accordance with the principles of justice, democracy, respect for human rights, equality, non-discrimination, and good governance and good faith. And that's it. So we have questions for discussion. Which of these subtopic issues are a priority to the Maang, Loon, Dodem? The topics would be discrimination, equality, labor, work practices, wills, and estates. Any comment on that? Oops.
Feel free to use the chat if you want to have questions but are too shy to talk. Just you can put your question down into the or your comments into the chat and we'll address them.
I have to there we go. I lost my chat and everything. Basically the entire, all of the articles would probably pertain to the Maang as we had it had explained, but does anybody feel there are any priority in any of those topics?
So I lost track of the definition or the scope of Maang clan. Is that the internal governance?
No, it is all about discrimination. It's all about, let me look back at the, let's go back to the very
the clan function, the clan.
Yeah, they basically are dealing with equality, discrimination, human rights, racism, wills, estates, and workplace employment, okay, labor.
So the broader scope of the Maang clan is internal governance, right?
Yes, it is.
For the application of UNDRIP, that's where these areas have deemed to be of more interest under the Maang clan.
Yeah.
Okay, in terms of their internal governance responsibilities.
Yeah, because the Crane clan actually is the external chieftain. So they would deal with anything with international stuff or intertribal stuff, those kind of things. This would basically be just within the community.
Gotcha. Okay.
So back to the questions. Oops. Which of the subtopic issues are a priority to the Maang?
Marina has just said that seems like all of them are important.
They are all important.
I don't know if you want to elaborate on that, on anything, Marina. Discrimination is definitely a priority.
Yeah. I believe so. I think it's something that we can even identify with within our own community, right? That can be an internal thing as well.
Hello.
Can you hear me? Hi, Deborah. Yeah, we can hear
you. Hi. I work for the Munsee-Delaware Nation, and I guess, you know, the topic of interest is regarding the employment and labor part. And I know that everything is important topics to address, but I think for years that we've been so discriminated against in employment and labor practices for First Nation that we do need to pick that up somewhere and move it as a priority. And I'm coming from an employment and training perspective as well, because I worked in a field for more than 20 years now. And I think, you know, that I really would like to see our people treat it with equality in the employment sectors. And also the fact that, you know, we've paid so much to the government in our taxes, and that we have that ability to be tax exempt. And I think that many of our people have not filed their income tax and retained, or, you know, even tried to prove that we're going to be able to, and you know, be able to be exempt from the income tax. So right. kind of my thoughts.
I think, yeah. And just to build on that, I think when you look at internally in terms of responsibilities of the Maang clan on internal governance, in terms of our internal discrimination between one, how many times have, I know I've heard it a couple of times, you know, you go to work for your First Nation and you should be grateful that you're tax exempt and that's the reason why you're paid so low.
But you're not making
it anymore. Yeah, we can't give you wage parity. Yeah. But, you know, factor in the fact that you're tax exempt and be grateful. So that's yeah. a systemic internal mechanism that we really have to attend to.
Yeah, it's a cop-out, right? It's a cop-out. It's not fair because that should be one of the benefits. Even if you do have a decent wage, that's an equitable wage, you know, you shouldn't feel bad that you're getting it taxed, right? It's certainly not, it's not fair. It's not a fair practice. And it's an offloading of the racism, you know, that and discrimination from the government levels that we put upon our own, our own staff. It's not fair. It's definitely not fair. And what they do is the government does it on purpose. They don't think of it as, okay, this is how much you're going to pay your managers here. This is how much you're going to pay for each program, each employee. They just say, here's the amount of money. You have to determine how much you're going to pay each person. They just throw it at them in a lump sum. So
exactly, and I think that's
they don't
what a
give
lot
them
of,
enough.
Yeah, the communities are grappling with that. Look at the example for waste. Water operators, you know, we were under such pressure to comply with standards and get our operators trained. And when they did, you know, at an equitable level to their municipal colleagues, they're paid $15 an hour versus $50 an hour in a municipality. So what's your option, you know?
Yeah.
You love your community, you want to work for your community, but you're, you know, there's got to be some balance there.
That's right. That's right. And that's been an age-long issue. Yeah. You know, yeah. I was a band employee before too, and providing services to you know, that had to be comparable to an off reserve agency that provided services. And what the one person in the outside agency made and their outside agency was what my entire department worked
had
with.
To rely
and
on.
I had to, they had like 125 staff in the off reserve agency. Yeah. And I had to run the entire department on what that one person made out there. That's what our entire department ran on. And, you know,
absolutely. And, you know, there's a lot of effort and advocacy, and I can see the difficulty and challenges ahead, you know, as this shifts. Because even though you do external advocacy to get satisfactory funding for the First Nations broadly, I can remember back in the 90s for welfare administrators, you know, comparing to municipal welfare administrators, our wage was not some, you know, some of it was just honorarium, you know, it was actually shocking, but we advocated for wage parity and it was successful. The province agreed to it. Mind you, the feds paid it back to the 65 welfare agreement, but it was at the First Nation level where they wouldn't implement it because you couldn't make more than the chief and you couldn't make more than a band administrator. But why not use that as the impetus to work, you know, with more quality across the board? I think a lot of our communities and organizations are still grappling with that balance.
Yeah. Well, even right now there is dollars that are there. I was at in Grandma last week at a the band rep conference, and there was a lawyer that was there, and she said there is almost $400 million still sitting there waiting for the band rep programs to come and grab it. Tell us what you want to do with it. You know, if you want to hire a lawyer, you want to hire, like, give better pay to your staff. And what some of the buzz around the table was, we asked for that and we were told, you're not going to get that kind of money because you're going to make more than the chief. Well, what's, is that one reason that you don't want to insult the chief? You don't care that you have consistency and qualified individuals that are adequately paid, that work around the clock, looking after the children that are the future of your community, right? So there was some grumblings going on, you know, that is the money even going to get spent? That was, you know, the lawyer that was there telling us all that, like, when you guys are going to start making some plans, making some movement, come and use up this money, because it's, the tap's going to stop, right? It's not going to be there anymore. But some of the people were saying, well, I was told that you're not going to get that kind of money because of those same things that you were mentioning. You can't make more than the chief. You can't make more than the CEO, you know, that kind of stuff. So we got to get past that, right?
I have a comment in from Marina Plain. The federal government has communities competing for inadequate funding annually.
Mm-hmm. Yep. It is inadequate funding. And they make you jump through flaming hoops to get that money, just throw you a bone, right? It's not fair. It's not fair. And that's a discrimination. That's a practice of discrimination.
And we were talking earlier about funding. When you do get funding, by the time you get the money, the year's over. They want you to do all these things, your work plan, but then all of a sudden you've got, you only have 2 months to get this done. You know, that's frustrating.
That's right. They don't even give you a chance to do proper planning. Oh, we have $100,000. We need you to spend it, you know, before the year's end. And, you know, you got 60 days, 30 days to do it.
Well, mm-hmm. Yes. It's hard on the staff that are completing those tasks as well, because that's impacting their health. Right? That's stressful. So that's impacting their health. And then, you know, how the healthcare dollars work too. It's the same thing with the healthcare dollars. Right. So more discrimination in another department.
You're absolutely right.
Just a revolving door. That's for sure.
It's so not right in how they operate.
No.
Or you'll get an email from the, and they say, oh, you know, we have this extra money. You know, we need to get off our books. Do you want it? And it's timelines, right?
Do you want it?
Yeah.
Do you want it?
You want it, but you only have so many days to finish it and have an awesome report when you're all done.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of the money, when you say you don't have the time or the staff to fulfill such a thing, then you didn't want the money. You guys must be doing all right. Okay, what issues of discrimination and racism do you feel to be a priority? I'm missing part of it here. A priority for Anishinaabe people. We kind of talked a bit about them, right? We talked a bit about that already.
I have something, Kathy, just in regards to working off reserve and whatnot, and you mentioned something about the changes to legislation in 2012 for self-identifying the affirmations. A lot of individuals are self-identifying, and I don't think they fully understand what self-identifying means. I just read the Pali case and whatever, and they have to be accepted before you self-identify, but not just Métis, but our whole entire First Nations, Inuit, and Métis increased the population of 50-something% in 2011 or whatever it was.
Yeah.
So do these rules apply to individuals off reserve as well? Non or Indigenous organizations that are utilizing the employment laws to hire Indigenous people, but not getting them to sign that affirmation?
Well, to some degree, that as an individual, I used to work in the Friendship Center movement, and I used to claim my time because North Bay was very close. It is very close to Nipissing, right? So, and I lived on Nipissing. So what I did was I just kept track of all my time working on the reserve and my time that even I collected my sick days, my holidays, all of those times, right? So I was able to get back a lot of my money. So now they say that, you know, you can do that self-identifying thing as long as you get something from your employer. And at that time it was the Friendship Center. And you're, and if your organization is mainly servicing Indigenous peoples on or off the reserve, there isn't, that's another caveat that you can actually take advantage of. So there might be people that are not self-identifying, but they may be going in the back door, like when they do their income taxes kind of thing. You can do it that way too, but it depends, right? You're going to get assessed. Every time I did it, I got assessed every single time. Every time I got assessed, but never did I ever have to pay any of it back because, you know, they saw, okay, she does live on the reserve. She works for an Indigenous employer, but I've not seen anybody else that it didn't work, but all they do is just say, you've already paid it. We're not giving you any money back because it's a payback kind of a thing, right? But to take it off at your paycheck, you have to have some cooperation there with the First Nation employers. You have to have something there. So you can't just arbitrarily say, well, don't take that off my paycheck. You have to have the cooperation of your employer to do that. And so then you probably have to do your identifying, your self-identifying and things like that. But it's become, the self-identifying is becoming a larger part of working with Indigenous peoples and the government, like right into the courts. So even how they identify First Nation children and child welfare is they have a criteria there. You don't even need to be a band member for the First Nation to be responsible for children now, as long as there's some kind of a connection, as long as if the child identifies with the community, it doesn't have to be a status. So it's getting to be different, but I don't know if that's good. I don't know where it's going to go.
I read an article from one of the different provinces where there was a professor who self-identified as Indigenous, and then someone checked into it and it turned out she wasn't. There was no, I'm not sure if you all remember that. And they said that if they utilize that form, they could turn back, and she self-identified that way without any proof, they could charge her for like criminal charges of fraud.
Probably, if she's benefited financially from it, she probably could be. Just depends on the circumstances, right? But you hear about it all the time. They call them the pretendians.
Yeah.
The pretendians. There was like an author, a famous author that put out books and was saying that they were Indigenous, and they got uncovered. It turned into that this person really wasn't. And so it, you know, the books were flying off the shelves before, but then, you know, now it's bathroom reading or fiction novels now. It's not even real. But yeah, it's getting exploited for sure, because it's getting almost to a watered down effect. And it gets a little gray sometimes. Like even you have some people that they probably should be pursuing First Nation status, but they find it a lot easier to walk into the Métis Nation and get a Métis card. And they're getting like great benefits in there. Like it's crazy because they're getting education paid like nobody's ever, like First Nations don't even get education monies like the Métis get right now. So they're pretty much able to give you whatever you want except for land. They don't have any land base, but they have a lot of everything else. And it's kind of, you're going to see it more now. Like you're going to see the Métis Nation is starting to look at all the Algonquin Nation, the big land claim there. A lot of them are Métis fighting to get a piece of the land over there. So they're sneaking up. They're sneaking up for sure. And I think it should be a concern of the leadership for them to do some establishing of territories and stuff, like be a little more hard-nosed. I just don't understand why there isn't a movement. This is my personal opinion. Why there isn't a movement to allow for First Nations to take the Métis in. Now, my reasoning for that is the Métis came from somewhere. They came from First Nations. They can trace themselves back to First Nation lands. And the Métis part of it is because they had colonial imposition into their strand of their biological strand became compromised with the colonial experience. So it created, you know, they didn't like just come from, you know, another planet and there's a Métis person. This was because of the colonials and the indigenous peoples that created a Métis person. Well, you would think that there would be more power in taking in the Métis nation and creating stronger nations of our own, right? We're all swimming in the same direction, really. But, you know, some First Nations say, nope, we don't want Métis at all. But I say there's strength in numbers. There's strength in numbers. But that's my opinion of it, right?
My band is Waskaganish way up on the Quebec side, and they won't accept me as a band member.
Yeah. So you know what? That's unfortunate. Let me tell you something else. INAC is arbitrarily, they're messing with First Nation membership lists and try to get anything out of them. And it's like pulling teeth. They're taking people like you, Linda, and they're saying, we're going to put you on another list. We're putting you on a First Nation list. And they just, because there's a lot of Indigenous people that don't have a community that are wanting to take them back for many reasons. So then they say, well, we don't want to be responsible for them, because if that First Nation isn't responsible for them, then INAC himself has to be responsible for them. So they're trying to offload their responsibilities.
Yep.
Before governance gets too deep, right? So they're saying, you know, we have some communities that are contacting us and saying, all of a sudden we have like a whole bunch of new members. Like they're saying, oh, INAC, well, INAC said that we're now on your list. So then we're getting some communities are contacting and saying, we need to have an audit of our membership list. Like they're just arbitrarily telling us that you now have these new members on your list. So they're questioning, like, who are these people that they're letting into our communities? And rightly so. But, you know, when a First Nation tries to get a hold of their membership list at INAC, it's like a fight, because INAC is saying, you don't have property in that list. And they said, well, you're giving us people on our list, but we want to, like, some of them want to know what's the origins of putting them on their list, right?
They don't want any more people on their list, right? I don't blame Waskaganish. Yeah. They, you know what, they probably have limited resources as it is. And then adding six of us are in my family, adding six more members to their list is like less resources, right?
Yep, that's right. So, but I still believe there's strength in numbers. And when it comes down to it, it's my belief, this is not anybody else's belief, this is my belief, that when it comes down to the governance, they're going to say, what's your bottom line? Your bottom line is going to be in direct relation to the population on your membership list, your citizenship, numbers of citizens. I say, welcome them all in. Bring them all in and make them pay. Make them pay, you know. Anybody that you can get in on your list will bring strength to your community. That's what I believe. But other people are not, they're not of the same thought, right? But that's what I would do. I would say, you know, let's bring them all in and let's give them a place to call home. And, you know, we got to make sure that people are, you know, going to bring some value to your community. Most people have some value that they're going to bring with them. So, you know, you can increase your capacity. You know, human resources is a great resource to have. The more you have, you know, you can be rich. Okay, so what concerns can employment and labor practices for First Nations be resolved with UNDRIP? Well, we talked a bit about that. We talked about wage equity, wage parity. I think that's important. And you know, there is some of those connecting factors. I think First Nations should have their own employment law act. There should be something for First Nations, just like you're creating your own child welfare act, your own governance for your community. I think you should have your own employment law too. I don't think it should be any different. And I think in that it should be that you're gonna have an equitable wage that's gonna be comparative. They should have more comparators. It can't be that hard. It's not like we're running so many different programs here that are not matchable to what's out in the mainstream. Like we have police services, we have healthcare workers, we have teachers and daycares and child welfare departments in the communities, and we have personal support workers, all of those things. Well, why are the lives of First Nation people so worth less? We're the first people of this nation. We're of the land. We should be, I just find it amazing that with all of the resources and riches that come out of our communities every single day, that we're still the poorest of people of the nation. And we should be the richest. And I still believe that as First Nation people, we should be able to live as rich as we want to live, because the money that comes out of our and the resources every day from Canada, it's a shame. So I think, wage equity for sure, wage parity to comparable services that are in the mainstream, that's, that would certainly help to bring up the standards of living and the level of care that our elders get, that our children can live with, all of those kinds of things. I think that's important. And we wouldn't have such high turnover rates. I did some work with the band reps during the summer months, and the differences in wages, even though there's been a bit of a funding hike, it's not made a significant difference. And people still don't make enough. It's really sad. They don't make enough money there. Okay. What issues do you see as important for wills and estates for Anishinaabe people? I think
Kathy, in regards to the employment, in regard with Marina's comment about having us compete and whatever, for employment, like I know we have special rights and whatnot. Does that protect our stats as well? Because there's a lot of like non-Indigenous organizations. I'm not saying this is happening, but let's just say John Howard Society, who is gaining stats to serve First Nation individuals and then applying for funding, and then taking the funding away from other organizations, right? Is there any protections for that?
I don't even know. I know what you're saying though, because it happens all the time. Because I think because First Nations are so under-resourced, human resources, like there's jobs, but there's not enough people to do them. They don't make enough money. They don't have the pay to really, there's too much a turnover rate. So people are they feel like they don't have enough. It's like a one-legged step dancer. You just can't stop, right? You're going steady. And where do you find the time to do proposals, to write proposals, to get this money? You can barely keep above water with all of the phone calls around the clock, with, when you're working in your home community, everybody knows who you are and how to get a hold of you. They just pull in the driveway, and then next thing you know, you're trying to barbecue for your dinner and you got people coming in to, tug your ear. You just don't have time, right? So there is probably resources. There's probably money that's out there. And then as it starts to get close to being stale, they'll say, to an off-reserve organization. Do you guys want this money? Do you service Indigenous population? Yeah, we have some in the urban center. Okay, well, if you can give me something, you can have, you know, $100,000 towards a program. Well, the First Nations lost out because it was there, it was offered to them first, but they do not have the same capacity. They don't have the same things going on where they can easily just, you know, craft something up and sign it up immediately and off it goes. So, you know, I saw that happen before too. When I was working in the band, we talked about monies for victims, program dollars for families of that witnessed violence. Well, it turns out the community counseling office in North Bay had been getting this money annually for like 10 years. And they were trying to run a child witness program there. And I said, well, how come we can't get that money? They said, well, you guys never ever took it. So then we had to develop a partnership so that they could increase their numbers. So, and use the money. So then we had a partnership there, and I provided all the families to go to a program, but they got the money because they were on top of it. They had the resources to apply for all of that stuff. We didn't, there was me in the department when I was doing band rep and child welfare. There was me, and I had to answer to all the voluntary agreements, any adoption inquiries, interventions that came along, court duties, everything under the sun, everything that the Children's Aid Society in North Bay did. They had 125 staff. Anything and everything they do, I had to do it myself, and I had to provide it in a timely and efficient manner with the same amount of money that they had for one salary out there, which is not fair. So like, where do I find the time to do proposals to go after this kind of money? It happens all the time. It still happens all the time. And you know, when I did discussions with the band reps this past summer, there was a lot of new faces, and they all said, oh, I'm new. Well, it's because anybody that's been in there for a long time in child welfare is like, I'm tired. I'm getting out of this. I can't do this anymore. This is too stressful, especially COVID. We lost a lot of workers, right? So do they feel confident when they first get into the job to say, oh, I'm going to do proposals for this, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that? It doesn't happen, because you get everything thrown on you in one shot, and you feel like you're overwhelmed right from the beginning of the job, right till the day you walk out the door. So there's very few senior band reps, senior child welfare workers that have been there for a long time. There are some, but you talk to them and they're fed up. They're very fed up. They have passion, but it's overshadowed by their frustration with the whole system. And that's not new. That's not only in child welfare. That's goes through just about every department that's there, right? There's inequalities in pay and services, and it's very tough.
Hi, I'm just thinking that maybe we could, like, we're talking about concerns, and those are all the concerns we all carry that you just mentioned. But what if, like, so could we, like, some solutions, like, are the concerns are that there's not enough partnerships, that there's not enough consultation, you know, like, because if the agency next door to me is an employment agency and they're getting 200,000 and all I get is 100,000 to do the same job, so why can't they be accountable to the First Nations? You know, why can't we look at those kind of concerns, like, at a higher level rather than the frontline level, and start negotiating those kind of things?
That's right. Well, that's what like the number three in there, what concerns can employment labor practices,
right?
So
right.
if we're able to have our own employment laws in the First Nations, just like with the child welfare,
right?
You know, we're making our own laws. We can make our own labor laws, employment and labor practices as well. so we can make it that it's equitable, those kinds of things, right? We can do that. When we have UNDRIP in place, then we can say it's not fair, right? And they're gonna have to do something about it. That's what this is all about, is making it different. So, and making it fair, making it equitable, so there is no discrimination, those kinds of things. Like First Nations should be able to have their own codes, their own laws, their own practices that would be fair, right?
Because I think there's also another part to that, and that's like immigration, you know, like people that are brought into Canada or into Ontario to do the work, that our people never have that opportunity or have little opportunity to participate in higher level agreements, like say with the agricultural societies or whoever they might be that hire a lot of the people from immigrations coming into our territories.
Mm-hmm.
Not to say that it's bad, just to say that we also need that same kind of opportunity to employ our people.
Mm-hmm.
And the same kind of resources to get our people equipped to do those kind of jobs.
Right. So how would you see that happening?
I think that there would be like quotas in the First Nation, like how many people are you bringing in, and how many First Nation, Métis, and Inuit people hired.
Yeah.
Like, let's look at, I guess it's mostly like the equality piece.
Mm-hmm. How do you feel about the self-identifying factor?
It hasn't impacted any of our things other than in education. I think, you know, self-identifying in the education sector gives them a lot of tools to really find out who's who and in the education system. But I think employment and training, I know they're self-identifying, you know, on our participant information forms and your intake forms, and they don't get any special treatment, even though they're self-identifying as an Indigenous group, that they should be given the information so that they can understand and qualify for the jobs that are out there.
Right.
And that are specific to our people.
Mm-hmm. I guess some of the employers have different funding pots. There's different strains of funding if you hire an Indigenous person.
Yeah.
So that's where that little ticked off box, the little check mark there that says, yes, I'm Indigenous, would allow for you to be paid out of a different pot or in addition to or something. I don't know. But I don't know if somebody that was to just self-identify and they weren't legitimately entitled, if that would, you know, be taking away, that would definitely be taking away from somebody who is legitimately a First Nation person or a non-status person kind of thing. But, you know, that's, I guess we'll be arguing on a case by case basis. Okay. So did we talk about issues most important for wills and estates? Was that the lands? What are the most important issues for wills and estates for Anishinaabe people? I think we sort of talked about something like that, about not having a status heir.
Yeah, and then the importance of a citizenship code or law.
That's right, yeah. Okay. Because from my understanding of the citizenship movement is that the first round of talks does not include First Nations being able to give status. They're going to be managing their own citizenship, but through future negotiations, that is what the hope is that First Nations will be able to determine their own citizenship and the benefits like the benefits right now are status. So I think they want to increase the benefits of the citizenship to make it overshadow the benefits of status. That's what I'm sort of understanding, is that it's going to be more beneficial to be a citizen than it is to be a status. They want to take that over, and eventually with negotiations, that's what the hope is that First Nations are just going to say, we're going to look after it all ourselves.
Then we would be able to get monies for individuals who self-identify to yes. help provide services to them.
And then that they would be, they would increase the capacity of your own citizenship office to be able to manage their own citizenship lists and all of that stuff, all of the good stuff. So how can UNDRIP support Indigenous people in their efforts to eliminate discrimination? Well, what do you guys think about that? How can UNDRIP, how is UNDRIP going to be able to help all of this?
Well, from what I understand and what I've heard is that there's a lot of unresolved human rights cases sitting wherever. And if they haven't been able to, whatever system they have in place hasn't been able to resolve a lot of the cases that are sitting there. So I think that in that sense, I don't know if there's a report that comes back and you can see, you know, what the difference is in resolving situations. And because to me, that seems like it's already discrimination towards us if we put a case forward and it never gets resolved.
That's right. There should be some way that once it is resolved, like if there's cases that are going through, there should be some kind of a collection of those cases that can help to build up our own, right? Build up our own cases, and we call it stare decisis or precedent setting. You want to have your own precedent setting as far as when situations are resolved, that will help to advance the strength of our own laws. You want it to be able to allow our laws to be able to evolve, right? So I sort of get that. But we need to be able to have UNDRIP do what they say they were going to do. And that would be to make sure that all the laws of Canada would be in aligned with the articles of the UNDRIP. So, and it would have to be in accordance with our own customs and our own intent, right? And not, and that's basically what they're trying to do now, is to get feedback from the First Nations to see how this could be done effectively. Because it's going to be up to, you know, the political organizations like the Anishinaabeg Nation to be able to go around and work with the communities to say, how do we want UNDRIP to be blended into the laws that are there? And it's going to take time. It's going to take a long time, but it's for them to rewrite all the laws, it's going to take a lot, and they'll be challenged, but it'll help to create a stronger platform for Indigenous people. But it's going to be up to the loons. It's going to be up to the loons. Does anybody else have any comments or questions?
There were some concerns just from other engagement sessions. And I understand the intergenerational traumas and the effects of racism and all that. So people don't believe that UNDRIP is going to work. And one individual even asked, because we're changing, governments and stuff like that, is there any loopholes where the government can get out of UNDRIP by trickery or?
To get out of?
Yeah, to get out of it by not implementing it into the or to like, because it's not considered a federal legislation, right? It's just a universal tool.
Yeah, but I think what they want, like the intention is that all the federal and probably provincial legislation would have to be amended to be in line with what UNDRIP is saying, right? That the concerns that they have about the fairness to the Indigenous people would have to be written into the, like, to change how legislation is, right? To be fair. So if there's any discriminatory legislation or regulations or policies, whether it's of Indigenous, like this is not just writing UNDRIP just for the First Nations. This is going to be writing all the laws of Canada. It's going to be like, they're going to go through the criminal code. They're going to go through everything. Like it's got to make sure that all of the laws of the land are going to be not discriminating or cause inequality for First Nation people in any way, shape or form, right? So you're going to opt out of it for what? Because you want to be discriminated on? You want inequality? That doesn't make sense. Doesn't make sense to me at all. But
I have a comment here in the chat from Marina. They should have an Indigenous Advisory Council while they move forward with the implementation.
Absolutely. They should. Yep. An Indigenous Advisory Council.
Yeah.
They do absolutely. Sorry, go ahead.
Oh, with the missing and murdered report. Mm-hmm. National report, that's what they are doing, but I'm not sure how successful that's going, but I think they can model it after that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, the Department of Justice has an Indigenous Advisory Council as well, so it's not like it's not been done. It is done, so I think it's a great idea. And it should be, that should be a recommendation that comes out of all of this, that there should be an advisory council for the for this to be transitioned and for oversight, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So, yep, that's a good idea. I think that should be a recommendation. Does anybody
have... recap, Christy? And
yeah, go ahead, Christy.
I'll recap. All right. I always write lots. All right, so there was some questions in regards to the employment income. If we're like due to COVID, individuals had to work off reserve, and then with COVID came in to working on reserve. So there was tax exemption questions. Also in regards to the definition of normally living off on reserve, how would someone prove that? And then wills and estates in regards to the CPs, how can we legally allow CP lands to still remain to our families, even though some of our families may not be part of the statuses? And you suggested this is the importance of our citizenship laws in each of our First Nations, and perhaps the one parent rule coming into effect. CRA pension plans in regards to taxes, we need to have noted on file that some of our pension plans are from employment. Other ones, employment and labor laws have been within our First Nation have created a lot of discrimination, especially in regards to our own individuals not being treated fairly There was a lot of confusion up to, I think, 2007 in regards to what legislation we follow. A lot of individuals followed the federal, and now they're saying provincial. So there was a lot of issues that came from that. Also, the factor that our jobs are tax exempt, so our wages are a lot lower, and we need to step up for work parity. Wage parity, sorry. The federal government having communities compete for inadequate funding annually. And it's not just funding like within the First Nation communities, it's like for Indigenous organizations, non-Indigenous organizations, we're all fighting for money. A lot of times when we apply for funding, let's say we apply for funding in April, we don't receive the funding till June. Therefore, there's only like 9 months to actually deliver something and get reports done and whatnot. So there's time constraints, and which ultimately sets some of our First Nations up for failure. Why are First Nations people worth less? And it's hard to get the INEC membership lists, especially when we're trying to add members to the list or figure out the origins of putting a person on lists. Utilizing stats for gain. Some organizations will utilize First Nations stats to gain funding. However, there's, you know, not enough resources in our First Nations to actually combat that quite yet. Some of us do not have the capacity to gain funding. There's a lot of frustrations with systems. There's inadequacies in all services and federal systems. Not enough partnership, not enough consultations. The wages again came up. There's no real accountability to First Nations. UNDRIP perhaps can, you know, help us gain our own employment labor laws to create more equitable and fairness across the First Nations. It feels like we never have an opportunity for different funding sources, such as like agricultural society. A lot of individuals, why can't we do that same type of partnership where instead of hiring immigrants, we could hire First Nation individuals. Quotas in First Nations in regards to quality. Even if you do self-identify in some of the First Nations, there's no real special treatment that you will receive because a lot of us have membership codes and whatnot. So you would not gain a status from it. However, there's no real factor into that. There's different funding streams paid under different pots. So as we're self-identifying, individuals would fall under. And again, stressing the importance of the citizen law and determining, you know, our own citizenships in our First Nations. Maybe this is where self-identifying can be looked at as a positive, and where increased to fundings for community members can be serviced and whatnot. There's a lot of human rights cases that are unresolved right now. However, if all these cases are combined, and it can work to advance and strengthen the laws of First Nation laws, which can help build the employment laws and include an UNDRIP within that and start creating like the precedents and whatnot. And amended to be in line with UNDRIP. And yeah, that's just having an Indigenous Advisory Council as UNDRIP moves forward with implementation so that we can ensure that you know, measures are being met and that there's room for recourse. And that is it. Did I get everything?
That was lots of information.
Yep.
Yeah.
Which is good.
Yeah.
Perfect.